And this would happen exactly in a sudden realization of the human being in the Yangzhi, where basically two things are happening. On the one hand, the human mind perceives heaven, Zhitian, but for Tang Chun Yangzi, the opposite is happening. Heaven perceives itself in the human mind. This idea, you have it, of course, in Buddhism, but you also have it in many Western expressions of speculation about this relation between human mind and the absolute. You could find it in Plotin, you could find it in Spinoza, and many other Western thinkers. So it's not very particular, conclusion. Maybe different from Mengzi, Wang Yangming, Tang Chuni is thinking about actually the epistemological status of this idea of human nature. He thinks, how can we know? When reading Mengzi and Wang Yangming, you find this allegory, for example, the person going to the well. But it's never really clear how Mengzi actually meant this. Is this a proof, an empirical proof? Is it an example for how the psychological workings are to be understood of a human being? Is it just a philosophical reflection? It's not really clear. And I would argue the same problem you encounter when you read Wang Yangming. You have these many allegories of what a human being essentially is, but the status of it, is it a philosophical idea? Is it just a conviction? Is it a historical fact? We don't know. Tang Chuni different. He explicitly states this to be a religious faith. I think it makes him interesting. What he explicitly says is, you either believe that human nature is this way, or you don't. If you believe it, you are basically a member of the community of Confucian religiosity. Zhong Jiao Shi. It's not saying Zhong Jiao, but Zhong Jiao Shi. If you don't believe it, you're not. You're free to choose. You could say that's an easy way out, but at least it is a way out. And it proves that he had a perception there is a problem with these examples in the monks. I would say there are two immediate consequences for Tang Chuni's conception of history in general, modernization in particular, from this idea of a Confucian belief and this limited concept of the Shenren and the Yangzhi. First of all, the individual human being cannot be permanently transformed into a new man like Marxism would have, no matter how successful modernization might be. Modern Confucianism does not envision a community of new men like in Marxism. And for Marxism, human nature is a product of historical and social forces and constellations. For Tang Chinese, modern Confucianism, human nature is unchangeable and only in a moment fully realizable in the action. The nature of man is thus beyond the reach of instrumental modernity. And second, Tang Chuni's historical speculation differs from Marxism insofar as it does not expect the coming of a man-made paradise on earth. On the other hand, neither does modern Confucianism consider the course of history as something completely beyond the reach of human beings. So we have no idea that paradise on earth could ever take form, but then also we don't have to be totally pessimistic. So basically that's the bottom line. To this ideal humanist world, which Tang Chuni sometimes mentions, it might become a historical reality, but only if individuals really engage into self-cultivation and are willing to establish institutions that match self-cultivation or help people conduct to do self-cultivation. So basically, they have to be in line with the ideal of becoming a sage. And that is more or less how Tang Chuni tries to explain why we should like to have a liberal democracy. Because for him, a liberal democracy is the one political form which allows everybody who wants to engage into self-cultivation without endangering their own life. He would argue that, for example, in a totalitarian system, you cannot engage in the self-cultivation because the whole way of how to think, how to live your life is basically politicized by this totalitarian ideology who tells you how to live and think. So we need some space of freedom that and he sees that in its political, historical form, the liberal democracy. So for him, and there again, I think it's quite an interesting idea, basically the final form of Confucianism is Western democracy. And for some historical reason, it never happened in the imperial period that Confucianism would achieve the one political form that really fits its ideals. So that had to happen in the 20th century, and those who triggered this development seemingly are these representatives of modern Confucianism. So they are not really modest. They see themselves as really important historical figures. So anyway, but it's a demanding task, because for Confucianism, the individuals know that they probably will fail in their effort to become a sage. Not even Confucius could do it, and some of it is the inquiry momentarily. So it's telling you, please try to become a sage, is not really something which makes you very optimistic, but say, okay, I should be able to achieve this. Very good. So I would argue this is why, in the eyes of Tan Chini, individuals need something which makes them strong enough to continue this road. And this is exactly a religious thing. It's not enough to have just a thin philosophical conviction. To keep on track, basically, he believes that individuals need something as strong and fundamental as a truly, genuinely religious belief in human nature. So I think there is some logic, if you will, why he labels his approach a form of philosophical belief, that's his words. Okay, so according to Tan Chini, the course of history is not predetermined by fate. He has talking about mean sometimes, mean good, but it doesn't seem that he believes that there is some unchangeable fate working in history. And he also does not believe that there are some other transcendent forces that just take their course in history. Human beings can become the masters of their own history, provided that they believe in their ability to master history. So you need a faith, and then you can maybe master history. You don't have the faith, you won't do it. And maybe this is one reason why some of these texts, when you read into texts produced by modern Confucianists, they sometimes have a very character of like appeals or manifestos. Not that many arguments, it's just they try to invoke feelings in the reader. I think they try to implement their ideas into history, because behind it is this conviction that we must have a belief and then we can basically master history. If we don't have a belief, we are just lost in the historical world. So maybe that is one function of what Tan Chini calls isotertia. It shall induce some kind of philosophical faith in the individual. So this philosophy of history fulfills an important function. By studying philosophy of history, individuals can gain the confidence or faith that human agency can embody the moral spirit or the principles of heaven, Tianbi, in historical reality. In other words, philosophy of history conveys the idea that human agency can capture the driving force of history and thus become the master of its own history. So obviously, we have with Tan Chini in particular, and probably modern Confucianism in general, a set of ideas that does not identify a final goal of history, comparable to the communist society, for example, in Marxist philosophy, or the final goal of individual freedom in human communities, such as the ethical state in German idealism. Confucian philosophers do neither expect the coming end of history, nor the salvation of humanity in history. So the question remains how human beings actually can know that there is indeed a progress taking place. Tan Chini does not expect the individual to blindly believe in the historical reality of the moral spirit. So now we're in the question of how can Confucian mind know that there is progress taking place? And why is there a necessity? Is there any necessity why history is progressing in a positive way? I would say we have not a very systematic answer in Kantian text, but we have something which reminds me a little bit of what we find in Kant's philosophy. Kantian highlights in his writings on history those historical events and developments which can be taken as a sort of signs indicating the historical reality of progress. I think you have this also now on the handout. On the second page, I'll just mention now Kant and his text, The Contest of Faculties. This idea of identifying historical signs was presented by Kant in the text, The Contest of Faculties, from 1798, so briefly after the French Revolution. I don't think that Tang Xuning actually read this text of Kant, but I think there's something about it there. The notion of historical science is probably apt to describe what Tang Xuning is doing. Kant identified the French Revolution as a historical sign of progress. Tang Xuning highlights, not the French Revolution, obviously, but he highlights the role of historical figures, maybe as signs that actually progress is taking place. So for him, people like Confucius, Buddha, or Jesus are historical figures, and maybe they stand for a kind of a sign for progress in human history. Apart from these figures, he also repeatedly emphasizes the progressive development of humanism, Renwen, Jingshen, in philosophy, culture, society, and focusing especially, of course, in China. So like other Confucian thinkers of the 1950s and 60s, Tang Xuning assumed that there was a humanistic main current, Zhuliu, that dominated China's historical development. By revealing the historical reality of this Zhuliu, including the many ups and downs, sometimes it was stronger, sometimes it was weaker, but it was always there, seemingly, Tang draws the image of a progressive development in Chinese history, culminating in the arrival of modern Confucianism in the mid-20th century. So I come to a conclusion. Tang Xuning reflects on methodological aspects as well, so it's not only this kind of theological, historical ideas he's developing when thinking about history. He's also talking, obviously, and Professor Wang also talks about this in his book, on scientific issues of historical research. Tang Xuning clearly fights against what we might call positivism or positivistic approaches in the humanities, and especially in research and history, because he thinks that any historical research is always linked to the historical situation of the person who actually is conducting the research. So he has this hermeneutical approach, thinking it's impossible as a historian to be so completely detached from what you do your research about that you could reach a level of objectivity which would be comparable to what you could reach in natural sciences, for example. For him, it's always clear we think out of our biographical historical situation, so it cannot be totally detached from history. We're always in history, even if we conduct historical research. For him, it was important to fight against these positivistic misunderstandings for several reasons. One reason is that he believes that positivism in the humanities functions like a secret agent of Western cultural imperialism. If unrestrained, it would lead to the conclusion that China's cultural tradition has ended with the demise of Imperial China, and that now, in the age of Western modernity, the ruins of Chinese culture could be analyzed in a detached, objective manner. This idea of please don't put Chinese culture in a museum, it's still living. That's his manifesto of 1958, very strong. Tang Xuning's criticism of objectivistic, positivistic historical research has also to do with his more theological assumption of modern Confucianism. A purely positivistic approach to history would be incompatible with the idea that historical thought is also part of Gongfu or Xiaoxiu. It's also practice. Studying history in this sense would mean that you are reflecting basically on human nature in history, and this could be a kind of a philosophical self-cultivation. So by studying history, the individual may learn what human nature is and how human nature manifests itself in culture and society. At the same time, the individual may also come to understand that human nature does not change in different historical and cultural settings, but essentially remains the same. So the study of history, if you will, reveals the impact of historical ideas, institutions, events on the human being, but it also reveals that human nature itself is unchangeable. And with this insight, you would gain something which would help you on your way, basically, to conduct social movements. So there is also this other side of historical thought. So according to modern Confucianism, this is, if you will, a measure of progress in history. So progress in history takes place whenever ideas, practices, and institutions which are in line with the ideal of self-cultivation achieve the position of a true leader in a society. And this is the idea of justifying liberal democracy. Exactly. So understanding liberal democracy as a historical form which is helping people to realize self-cultivation on a larger scale, many people can do it. If that would happen, you have historical progress. So this is basically the point of reference for the reconstruction, Zhongjie, of Confucianism and modernity. So on the one hand, we have an inner truth of human nature, which can be perceived. And this is, in a way, a non-changing point of reference for Tang Chuni to think of the turmoil he witnessed in his lifetime, the turmoil of modernity. So the optimistic outlook of the potential of individual self-fulfillment is matched by the optimism of progress in the historical vision. According to this optimism, humanity can create its own history and follow a progressive line toward a community of sages, although this community will never take place. But it's possible at least to move in this direction. And this is progress. So this vision is, according to Tang Chuni, powerful enough to shape the course of history. It needs this kind of conviction in the community. The process of modernity is thus neither a lost cause, nor is it a process beyond control. Modernity, as understood by modern Confucianism, is a historical project of humanity. This entails the promise that the seemingly unending stream of problems and disasters that occurred in the modern era can be put to an end. Apart from the question whether these concepts of modernity are adequate to describe reality, there is also a normative question I think we should ask. Do we actually want to believe that we can deal with modernity with such a highly optimistic expectation of progress and produce good results? Thank you for your attention.
Thank you very much. 非常感谢费教授，就是这么精彩的一个演讲。费教授提到很多，很多唐君毅很多很多有些概念，像现代性，比较对现代性的看法，对历史的描述，然后这个human agency， 就是人的这个行为能力或者人的这个主体性，能不能控制历史，或者能不能 guide 历史。 引导我们迈向一个更好的未来，这样子。对，非常精彩啊！那我想，也许我们可以先发一下，半小时的，不然大家都是一直在，对，一直看到这些食物的，懂明白？就吃不到这些食物。然后我们就请黄教授做一个回应啊。还是我们要休息一下，喝个水或者。
用吧，我们就边吃边谈吧，好不好？好。 好，谢谢这马教授邀请我过来，这个费教授你好， 还有我老师，我叫小金，我叫大家好。听知道老师的老广和腔调国语，我讲英文、讲法文、讲国语都要这个腔调。那对我来讲，当然是中文了，然后来谈过十几年，也近一点。我看我都讲国语，好吧？啊，
没紧张。
我想感谢马老师啊，大概两三个月以前呢、啊，他写信给我一个 email， 说是不是我们今天费教授给我们做个演讲，啊，来黄老师的，是不是给帮我们做一个对话对谈一下？当时我按照人家话我说马上答应说好，那结果可以让我们一个学习的机会。可是刚才听了大概一个小时多一点，啊，这个机会一方面很难得，可是也不好消化，对不对？因为费教授他当然讲稿了，可是我来讲，在这么短时间里面把它重点。 啊，要抓上来的话，加以回应，并不是很轻松一个任务了，什么纪律而为。首先的话，有些重点我抓的不太住，因为他讲也算是蛮快的，我编写还不及，所以这重点抓不住一点，我要先讲啊，先找个台阶下来，好吧？第二点呢，有些地方不见得是针对他所讲的这个回应和怎么样，啊，与其说是回应，宁可说是某方面我所知道的啊，昨天补充。 或者某些地方我根本不是很清楚的话，我利用这个机会来请教他。啊，所以以下的话大概是杂七杂八，把我刚才所听来的大概70分钟里面的重点啊，以及某些问题也许我能够回应的，我尝试做点回应。啊，如果真的回应不来，我看这个在座的武汉对唐老师有一定的研究，就帮我回应一下吧。啊，这么说好了，我本身是练历史的。 可是为什么对这个唐军也有兴趣呢？原因很简单，他是我老师，我是香港这个新亚研究所的，我还有幸徐唐毛啊、徐福官、唐军义跟毛中山都是我老师，上过他们的课。可是我本身是练历史的，练历史的话，上他课上徐福官，刚才提到徐福官的问题，好像没有提到毛中山，那。 我对他们都是很敬佩的，所以新儒家刚才讲过，新儒家从史力的三大弟子都是在香港里面啊，第二代的啊，徐唐谋三大师都是我的老师啊，所以我对他们几个都很敬佩。可是由于我本人的专业是历史的，所以就旁听他们的课啊，直接去所谓修学分的话是比较没有。毛老师是有毛老师的什么心体性体啊，啊这个康德等等都有修。可是唐老师我去读书的时候。 他是诞生是1906年，过世是1978年。我去的时候，唐老师已经晚年了，我是1976年去练研究所，当时唐老师已经重病了，啊，在1978年2月1号就过世了，所以去的时候根本没有太多机会能够听他讲课。他常常请假，身体不好，癌症肺癌，可能肺癌在上面讲一下，他是早上起床的，拿一根烟，点一根火柴，都晚上都不能再点。 为什么他一根接一根的抽嘛，所以何必要点第二根火柴、第三根？为什么不上？这个原因也许就导致他为什么肺癌过世。当然，毛老师来讲，不见得我也抽烟啊，不见得一定也抽烟就过世啊。毛老师活到87岁，他同年唐生跟唐先生出生1906年，唐先生1978年过世，毛老师是1905年，多活了他17年。所以毛老师说，不见得我也抽烟啊，可是我没有事啊。 那所以他从另外角度来解释为什么唐老师是比较短寿，事实上也不太短了，他到69，0.9到78嘛，69。那现在不谈我的所了解的，我非常感动，就是刚才听到费教授讲，他首先大家，毛老师讲到了，他说他先对我们的台湾的名人呢简惠水有兴趣，后来转来再研究唐老师，所以感谢他对我的唐老师啊，对我们的老师啊，怎么研究。 那我来说的话，唐老师过世以后，我是有点抱打不平。当时香港有个人叫徐玉，他写文章批评何老师，我就看不上眼了，就是看过去了，就写文章回应等等。从此以后，就开始断断续续的写点文章。可是后来出国读书，回来这边教书等等，都是偏重历史，我是历史系的专任老师了。所以唐老师。 啊，所写的东西文章书，我就暂时搁一旁，就没有再研究了。到那个六年以前，2006年有个机会去宜宾，宜宾是唐老师的，刚才讲到四川宜宾啊，这是武梁义，同学不喜欢喝酒的那个武梁义，你们都知道哈。 很著名的啊，开始啊，2006年开始去了的地方，慢慢从此要再重新把一根放在一旁的唐老师重新再捡回来。2008年我是休假，休假之后就把过去断断续续的若干文章，你加上2006年到去年吧，啊前年在2010年出的书，有时间再传一下，就把这个硕士论文挤的加上来，总共22篇文章，后来收在里面呢，大概17篇，10篇是作为藏篇，7篇则作为附录，就出版了一个书，600多页的一个书。大概这个人费教授看到啊，就推荐他，是不是费教授来讲的时候，你跟他费教授对谈一下。我是欣然应命。那其实我先把这个为什么应命啊，就跟唐老师一点点的师生的一种缘分嘛，跟大家做个很简单的报告。接下来的话，我稍微讲一下今天要讲的主题。我觉得这个费教授讲得很好，在我所知道，他是抓得蛮紧的，对于唐老师的思想啊，他的核心思想等等都抓得蛮广的。第一个，我先讲的话，唐老师他是个理想主义者、人文主义者，某方面来说，也是传统中文化的儒家精神的保守主义者。啊，所谓保守的话，我inverted comma不见得你保守，等会再讲什么叫保守。所以至少他是理想主义者、人文主义者，就是所谓某种程度上的文化保守主义者。那他当时来讲的话，1919年，民国八年，中国发生了大事情啊！民国八年发生了什么大事情啊？同学们，五四运动，所以新文化运动出来。那其中的主要的论调就是说，现在台湾的话就去中国化了。当时来讲，就是推崇西方科学跟民主，就把中国既有的东西的话抛在茅厕里面，就不要再看中国的古典等等。大家这个背景都了解，我就不用讲。可是由于唐先生啊，在某种程度上是文化保守主义者。他要回应这方面，你们这个武士健将要把我们东西丢掉，我们中国东西真的要这么烂，非要把它丢掉才能够引进西方的科学民主吗？他加以反省，反省的话就产生刚才费教授所讲的 modernity 现代性 ，modernization 的现代化两个概念不太一样，就出来了。出来的嘛，根据我的那个老学长他讲他说唐老师。这个脑袋啊，24小时不停的，读书当然是读书了，不读书吃饭就好，聊天好什么样，他都是不停的想，不断思考，思考的问题有好几个方向，中文化的怎么走啊，我的哲学怎么治下去，我怎么好好教书等等，都是他要思考的一个重要的核心。那今天不谈，解放我谈一下，他既然思考，面对中国人对中国文化所出来的挑战。所以去中国化要把西方的科学民主引进来，作为一个大思想家，他无论如何不会跳过这方面不思考的问题。既然民主跟科学，尤其是民主跟人权、自由等等是现在所谓的普世的价值、普世的真理，难道我们中国从来没有过吗？非要从西方引进来不可吗？他加以否定。既然这是普世价值，我们中国不会奔到这个地方。不会等到西方引进来我们才有啊，所以他透过文献的考察，把中国既有的民主、自由、人权精神找到根源。当然不光是他了，其他很多人包括他，从经典里面提出根据，至少精神上面我们中国绝不会排斥民主自由。从刚刚讲到良知良心，强调良知的人怎么会排斥以民为主的这种精神呢？非要以君为主不可能，良知。绝对不容许我们解放中国去接受军事大皇帝，其他老百姓一概被他视为的眼下的蚁民，把他当蚂蚁踩，不会接受。所以精神上，中国早已有之了民主自由精神，只是问题上制度上的确我们中国有所缺，没有建立一个客观的机制，这个机制就需要从西方学习引进来。刚才费教授也讲了 ，learning means repeat。learning means repeat 一个 experience， 把过去既有的经验把它学习过来。西方既有的经验，我们的中国人、不台湾人、不东方人吧，包括当时日本还不够民主，应该学习这方面就把它引进过来。说第一个，他肯定只有民主这个精神，中国早已有之，只是制度面没有开出来，没有开创出来，这个需要向西方学习。好，这个第一个大家刚才没有讲到，我稍微补充点。另外。他被视为新儒家，那么新儒家呢？ 从概念里分析，这是一个分析命题。既然是新儒家，它含两部分，一个是新，一个是儒家。所以新儒家包括他和第二代以及其他人，必须要有两个精神的兼顾，一个就是新，一个是儒家。既然被称为儒家的话，先秦儒家以孔孟为真传的，也许荀子是别派，我们以孟子、孔子为核心，这个儒家精神非得继承不可，要不然的话，你不能够被称为新儒家。好了，所以一定要传统先秦儒家精神的继承了。可既然称之为新的话，一定要异于愚者，不同于老而发现不变，不同于先秦的所在，不同于在哪里呢？你看看，我们作为按照刘书先的分类，三个时代，一个先秦儒，一个宋明儒，一个是当代啊，1920年代，所以民国9年有开始的，针对这个五四运动而来的这个第三代的啊，第三时期的新儒家。我们面对什么新问题呢？如宋明儒所面对的一个来是外来挑战是什么？最强大的宋代，从唐代甚至更早，从汉代末年开始，对我们中国已经来了是个外来什么东西？佛教。面对佛教的挑战，你不得不做的反应。所以宋明儒也算是一种新儒家是面对新来的外来挑战怎么回应？现代的另外一个挑战，现代这一代是来自西方。我面对西方的科学民主等等，我们怎么面对它？加以这消融、化解、吸收为己用，为我们所用，这个它就是新的概念。所以新儒家一方面维持既有儒家的精神，再来面对时代，必须要开出一个所谓新的外王。所以刚才讲到新外王，就是毛泽东没有举例来讲，我稍微补充新，所以针对面对现代时代这个挑战，我们如何去应付，如何去回应。啊，这是第二点，我稍微讲一下。将来的话，刚才讲到了 Holocaust 是大屠杀了，啊，尤其针对这个德国啊，在纳粹统治底下的大屠杀。刚才费教授讲到，一个人有这个蛮好的。那么大屠杀也新儒家啊，为了所有儒家都讲人性、人道、人文等等，你针对来自这个大屠杀的，你如何回应？尤其是中国啊，抗战的时候被日本所侵略杀了至少所谓30万的南京人等等等等，类似 Holocaust， 类似德国这个大屠杀发生在我们中国，这执行的人呢，不是德国人，是日本人，你新儒家如何回应？我回刚才提到这个问题，这个问题是蛮复杂的吧？他说，费教授讲，如果没有听错的话，他说，在他所看到的唐老师的文献里面，好像没有特别回应。这个日本人屠杀中国人，或者对中国侵略啊、杀什么中国人问题，好像没有回应。那徐福好像回应了，幸好我最近这几年这个书出来以后，我改为研究另外一个老师徐福。徐老师的确这方面稍微回应多了，比较多一点。唐老师印象中还没有特别回应这个大屠杀。啊，这个暂且不提了，因为再找文献的话，今天也来不及。那再来可是问题简单，他是日本呢、啊。唐老师1950年代好像1956还是58。去日本的时候，他对日本蛮推崇，而日本人在抗战的时候杀我们中国这么多人，为什么来推崇他？这个就回应到我刚才所讲，因为他是个理想主义者，是个仁者，仁啊、双仁为，他对仁者的胸怀，过去就过去了，不要记在脑袋里面。最重要一点，更是补充，我看过两篇文章，非常让我震动，唐老师所写的，唐老师用他以他这个仁者的胸怀，他所讲的话，大部分都是正面，当然某方面也提出这个负面的批判了。都是很正面的，都讲有更有趣的话。可是有两篇文章，至少只有一篇讲得很明显，非常非常这个谈批评啊，这个日本人。我看日期什么时候？日期是1937-38年，1937-38年什么时候？1937-38年是刚刚日本也入侵中国的时候。所以由此可见，尽管唐老师只不过仁厚的君子型的一个学者，可是对于面对这个国家存亡的时候，他还是做出一个非常激情性的一种批判文章，所以看到文章，完全不像唐老师平常文章啊，非常有一种煽动性的，表示什么？表示知识分子一种使命感。既我平常写文章很仁厚、很人道，可是面对国家生死存亡的时候，不得不发出另外一种非常激情性的一种文章，来唤起老百姓一种对日本抗拒的一种抗议的情绪。讲到这点呢，也顺便回应一下刚才费老师所讲的，面对 collectivism 集体主义，你中国人 想修身啊，这个人啊，怎么样成圣等等的。你面对这个集体主义，到底怎么看法？面对集权专制、日本人军国主义侵略我们，面对毛泽东杀这么多人，而且文革时至少两三千万人，我是列宁是比较知道。你如何面对？如何回应？这的确是唐老师，某种程度上用今天严格要求来讲，唐老师没有非常正面回应，可是也不能够讲完全没有回应，因为我刚才绕过讲，唐老师他一方面是哲学家，也是哲学史家，哲学家是照他思想来讲，哲学史家是照他学术来讲，可是同时他也是文化主义者，研究文化，研究历史，研究艺术。我这个研究历史的人，我看他所写历史的文章，我记得非常汗颜，怎么一个哲学为主轴的一个研究者，他居然对历史懂得这么多，懂得这么多，我非常震惊，也非常汗颜，非常惭愧。居然一个哲学家能懂得这么多历史的东西，这个题外话不谈。可至少唐老师他去日本的时候，像刚刚讲过，他是理想主义者，他过去就过去，过去就过去。那讲到解放面的话，刚才讲到，你怎么面对这个时代，面对这 collectivism。啊，或者totalitarianism啊，集权主义、专制主义怎么面对？唐老师的回应或者新儒家回应，也可以说是很简单，因为你要马上实践人道道德，说难非常难，要做一个圣人很难，说容易也是非常容易。唐老师这么说，《论语》里面不是有两句话吗？我欲人，世人至矣。哪一刻我定下一个实践人道，人道的落实下来的我身上，对不对？这样子再来的话，为人有己，做人道，实践人道，有我，而要人负责，难道要你帮我吗？不需要，你也帮不上忙，是我家的事情。用佛教立场来讲，放下屠刀，立可立地，成什么？成佛。说说容易，的确很容易；说难也的确很难。为什么？我先不讲为什么，先举个例子。刚才也提到过，颜回、颜渊，孔子娶他为人呢、啊？几个月啊？三个月。你孔子怎么推崇那个学生啊？只容许他，只赞赏他三个月，然后不违反人。三个月之后就没有保证了，保证不足，多难，多难。说容易很容易，说难。容易来，容易马上可以做，难在这一秒三的三这个2012年9月12号三点台湾时间3:11，立场得做什么？你保证12分13分能维持你这个人道这个立场不变吗？很简单，我说你先来讲，听我讲话，搞不好下一秒钟你就想到晚上这个月龄可能就见面了，不专注不敬嘛，不敬就是不仁。说说容易很容易，说难什么？难哪里？难在要时时刻刻，一天一天，两天三天四天，一个月两个三个月都维持下去，那就很难。现在中文所讲的修了，不断修。所以讲到上人，中国人按照传统儒家讲，从不要求人家当上人，只我自我习取。儒家最大的真理是哪里呢？就说严于自己，宽于待人，自己要求自己成人，可是。不必要求你成为，如果每一个人要求成为成为圣贤的话，这个太苛了。儒家讲要求什么？儒家讲的不是不违法，守法的，自我要求不妨高一点，希望成人。法以上的要道德要兼顾，可不能用这种自我要求要求你们，否则他就不算是圣人，也不算是儒家啊这个道理的维持，这个主义者，对不对？啊，这是我稍微做点补充的。那刚才讲到啊。毛泽东、斯大林等等，啊，到底怎么样？我刚才没有听得很清楚，跟毛泽东跟唐老师做个对比的研究，结果没有听得很清楚。可是最近刚刚看那个徐福光老师书，他历史上啊，对有三个人他最讨厌的，一个叫毛泽东，一个斯大林，另外一个希特勒，德国的发动二战的那个希特勒，毛泽东是文革的之前等等，还加上斯大林，他就最讨厌，这是。徐光，我今天也不谈徐，因为今天也来不及谈徐了，要有时间也许再谈。好、啊，可是回来就谈我们的唐老师。那刚才讲到啊，这个他是个理想主义者，面对这个现实上面怎么样处理，怎么样自我反省，事实上很困难。 怎么很困难？禅宗无非自我反省，反省就是这个觉，人就要讲到觉。佛教说的佛就是觉，要觉一小时很容易，两小时呢，三小时等等越来越困难，永远觉下去，那真的是太困难。那么这个也让我想起来，就说唐老师既然是一个，我把它定位为理想主义者，不光是我，很多人就是怎么说的吧。所以事实上，他所写的文章，他对其他人，甚至他对他自己本身的期许，有些地方的确不容易做到。就刚才提到那个非佛的一个信念，他把他所讲的理想，把他所讲的一种义理，我的看法跟很多人都一样，视为好比宗教一种信念。我希望如此，期许如此，事实上是否如此的话，恐怕他都不能保证。一辈子，唐老师为了跟当时中文大学斗争，所以斗争的话，我知道中文大学三个学院嘛，英国制的啊，一个大学的三个学院，信仰啊是推崇中国文化为依归的。可是归并到中文大学里面的话，你必须要给人家几权专制起来，就违反你这个信仰精神。信仰精神以什么精神？信仰精神就是传统中国。精神，所以中国精神就是所谓的人民主义啊，人民主义精神啊，不要你这个中文大学的所谓的香港英国政府统治底下的殖民政府等等啊，也不要你这个传统中国文化的，尤其当时的这个英国是承认当时的大陆所谓中华民国政权，而不承认中华民国政权，就承认中华人民共和国。中华人民共和国是什么政权？是唯物主义，唯物主义并且违反传统中国道德，唯物嘛，又为什么叫？中国人民精神、儒家精神都是讲精神的，你讲物，一定是啊不对头的。所以这个情况底下，啊一定是不能够支持你，啊以推崇啊中华民国为正统所在的依归所引申下来的那种所谓传统文化，这个香港说背后啊这个英国政府统一的，他既然介绍啊这个中共把它视为啊这个中国代表政府的，他不能够介绍这一套。这个情况底下，唐老师他就跟着 fight， 就跟着这个所谓说的就是斗争的抗衡。这个底下这个地方，让唐老师他再笨、再天真，也不会不知道现实跟理想总有差距。因为反过来讲，一旦理想落实下来的话，实现下来就变成现实了。一成为现实，也跟这个理想有冲突了，有落差了。所以不断把这个理想落实，把它现实化之后，就不断产生更高的理想，或者别的理想一样的追求。所以唐老师就是再笨，开玩笑，等觉得不会笨，也不会不知道理想跟现实是有蛮大的落差。可是刚刚由于他是理想主义者，他只有不断提出来，希望我们不断反省，不断觉，用一种所谓天真的一种精神来推翻太现实的、太向现实低头了那种啊，这个唯物主义啊、现实主义啊，或者他是称为禽兽主义等等。什么一个情况？我们刚才讲到这个非信念的问题，唐老师是很坚持，我的看法也是一样。他也知道这是一种非一种信念，事实上不见得。结果这个地方让我想起来，宗教比较好，宗教不是比较比较理想。这个现实生活不能落实上来的没关系啊，我既然是教徒，我有另外的世界，就有另外世界是未来世界 afterlife， 可是需要另外的世界去追啊，去实现我们现在这个世界实现不了。这是宗教徒的比较容易解决的问题，可作为儒家的信徒的唐老师的话，就永远不好解决。因为儒家就是当下有生之年要把这个理想落实下来，这是很残酷的，对内心的挑战非常困难。不像宗教徒，宗教徒简单啊，落实不下来的话，追求来生嘛，啊这样子就可以解决，至少在理论上没有基本基础可以啊，不现在不落实啊，太困难了、啊，没有。怎么样啊？说被集体主义啊，这个统治他里什么的，这个集权主义垄断，没关系，我有另外世界追求嘛。可是在儒家来讲，的确很也现实落实，就产生唐老师为什么一辈子啊要落实下来太困难。刚才讲到乐观主义，我特别想，某方面唐老师的确很乐观，可是也有比较悲观的一面。曾经的学长跟我说啊，他的好像这个日记里面还是书信里面讲到。他晚上睡觉常常大叫起来，就是梦魇睡不好。为什么？就是表示他的心中永远都记挂着中国民主精神怎么落实，中国文化精神怎么推出来等等。所以他写的文章很可能让我们看出来很乐观啊， 很怎么样？可是他现实上里面反映出另外一个真实唐居民，那就是他有悲观的面，也有这个心里面非常非常难过的面。所以，因为我是唐老师的学生，也许除了这个文献以外，我还有一点个人的体验，所以也许刚刚所讲的几点稍微啊，也许某种程度上啊，给这个费老师参考，让他说比较不知道哪一面啊，跟他分享一下。好，我们当然刚才他给我的时间好像15分钟嘛，我看已经稍微过了一两分钟了，我是很准时的，
没关系
啊，我很准时，而且剩下。